الذين يستحبون الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة ويصدون عن سبيل الله ويبغونها عوجا أولئك في ضلال بعيد. وما أرسلنا من رسول إلا بلسان قومه ليبين لهم فيضل الله من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء وهو العزيز الحكيم. ولقد أرسلنا موسى بآياتنا أن أخرج قومك من الظلمات إلى النور وذكرهم بأيام الله إن في ذلك لآيات لكل صبار شكور. صدق الله العظيم. Dear brothers and sisters, Surah Ibrahim alayhi salam is a full of lessons and aspect that all Muslims need to know. Ibrahim alayhi salam, first and foremost, we know Sayyidina Ibrahim ibn Azar, the one who was born, most historical like documents will say, in Iraq, in southern Iraq, toward Al-Basra. And he is considered to be the father of all prophets, meaning after him. And he is the foundation, if you wish, or the solid rock of the aqidah of tawheed. He is the one who questioned all Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creation and phenomenon in terms of the stars, and then the moon, and then the sun. And then he said, this is not my Lord. It cannot disappear. My Lord should be there all the time. إِنِّي وَجَّهْتُ وَجْهِيَ لِلَّذِي فَطَرَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And so he is the father of the aqidah of tawheed. He is the father of all prophets after him. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is claimed by Muslims, of course. He is the father of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, grandfather, we can say, as a prophet as well, and lineage. And he is claimed by the Jews, of course. And he's the father of Ishaq, and after Ishaq, Ya'qub, and from Ya'qub, the 12 tribes of Bani Israel and the rest of the prophets. And claimed by the Christian as well. So nowadays, there is what we call it Abrahamic faith. And this is a new term, it's been used for the last 20 years or so, that even though it's known before, but really mostly in the last 20 years and around and a little after 9/11 events, there become more and more claim, especially in the interfaith like community, people claiming, let's have the commonalities of the Abrahamic faith, which is the Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. Those would be considered Abrahamic faith, a group or religions, because they believe all in Ibrahim alayhi salam. So Ibrahim alayhi salam is a very important figure in the Islamic history and in the history of other religions as well. In the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Alif Lam Ra, Kitabun anzalnahu ilayka litukhrija an-nasa min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur bi'idni rabbihim ila siratil aziz al-hamid. We talked about the letters in the beginning of each surah, and some of the surahs, not all of them. And we said those are sort of alphabet of the Arabic, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenge humanity to come up with something like that. And then remember this emphasis on لِتُخْرِجَهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, to deliver them from the darkness into the light of al-Islam and the Tawheed. بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهِمْ إِلَى صِرَاتِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ, to the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Almighty, that deserve all kind of praise. Allah الذي له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض وويل للكافرين من عذاب شديد. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we know, is in control of what's in heaven and what's in earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala observe and look after, and of course, we don't really use the word manage, but under his control, everything goes on in this heaven and earth. الذين يستحبون الحياة الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة. So وويل للكافرين من عذاب شديد. And وويل is a threat to the كافرين, that they will face and they will get a very severe punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are they? Now, it didn't say that those who do not pray, or those who believe in other religion, or those who have like other faith and groups, and some of them they deserve because they are mushrikeen. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us, الَّذِينَ يَسْتَحِبُّونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى الْآخِرَةِ. Those who love dunya more than the akhirah. Not love dunya like normal love. That's I love to sleep, I love to eat, I love to enjoy life, etc. No. That's they mean they don't even believe in the akhirah. Or those who do not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in hayat al-dunya. If the people like hayat al-dunya and like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and love him and follow his guidance, nothing wrong. But those who deny the al-akhirah and who do not accept iman, then those are the ones who are menced into hayat al-dunya. وَيَصُدُّونَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. In addition to that, they are turning people away from the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَبْغُونَهَا عِوَجًا. يَبْغُونَهَا عِوَجًا. They intended to make it that way. The way that's hard for the believers and the people to be guided and to see through and to accept Islam and all of that. أُولَٰئِكَ فِي ضَلَالٍ بَعِيدٍ. Those are the misguided and they are way away from the path of Allah. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. فَيُضُلُّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Here there is another controversial kind of issue. And I hope that we can pay attention to it, even though we are not that many yet, but inshallah we'll have more participants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sent the prophet or the messages, he sent it with the language of the people who will understand. They will understand the language, and the prophets of Allah, they will speak the language of the people. So they can explain to them and make it clear. We cannot speak language that people will not understand. Now imagine if I want to just continue speaking this tafsir in Arabic. And maybe one or two understand Arabic, or maybe nobody understand Arabic. So imagine if I will go to Indonesia, Malaysia, or even like Bangladesh or India or any other country where they don't speak Arabic and start speaking Arabic. I am not doing da'wah. I am not doing tabligh. I am not delivering the message. Even Rabbul Alameen, when he sent the prophet, he sent them with the language that the people understand. And that is very important nowadays to know that to the best of our abilities, we have to master the language that the people speak so they will understand what we are talking about. And here, it was a debate always that some khutaba, some speakers and some like imams, they want to deliver the message or the khutbah in Jumu'ah in Arabic. And some of them, they want to deliver it in Urdu. And some of them deliver it in other languages. Well, this is not the wisdom of the Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us, or the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who used to say that talk to the people in a language they will understand. Don't talk to the people language that they will not understand. And that is the purpose of communicating. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, الرحمن, علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala علم الإنسان, taught the human البيان, the facts or the language to articulate. البيان, بيان is to recite or to say something that is documented or written in the language that people understand. So now you can say, I am doing tafsir or bayan on the Quran, tafsir of the Quran. If I will speak it in other language, other like than English, which is hopefully everybody understand, then it will become meaningless. It will be another like noise. And that's where we come to that agreement, and alhamdulillah, we emphasize it from the beginning, like long time ago. I'm talking about the early 90s when I was the president of the MSA in US and Canada, and I told told everybody, please, in the masajid, in the like MSA meeting, and as many as possible, every place, brothers, sisters, you speak English, so it is common language for the people here, and hopefully they will understand it. And now, there is nothing wrong with adding some of the verses or hadith or dua. That's most of time common. Most of the people understand the dua, understand some of the ayat or the hadith, and then we go over and explain the meaning. But it is very important, dear brothers and sisters, this lesson from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when you talk to the people, talk with their language. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا مُوسَى بِآيَاتِنَا أَنْ أَخْرَجْ قَوْمَكَ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. Again, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned dhulumat and an-nur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Musa, take your people out. Get them out of the place of darkness. قَوْمَكَ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. From the darkness into the light. Egypt was like dark. It was dark for dhulum, for not following Islam, for not following the deen. It was dark for the shirk. And Palestine, or like Jerusalem at the time, or that Holy Land, it does not mean that it is like light all the time, nur. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala represent the darkness for the shirk and the kufr and the worshipping of Fir'aun, and the light is for the tawheed and iman and worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَذَكِّرْهُمْ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ. So deliver the people from the ignorance and from the darkness and from the shirk into the day of the light of La ilaha illallah. And then remind them of the days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The good days and the bad days. The days that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created where there are suffering and hardship and difficulties. And the days that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided for us where there is ni'mah and blessings and great deal of blessings of Allah. إن في ذلك لآيات لكل صبار شكور. Those are ayat for everybody who is patient and thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dear brother and sister, there are so many ayat in this regard about Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam and his advice to the people. Now you can see that there is no in the Quran, and this is the style of the Quran, there is not much detail of like Ibrahim, okay, he is so-and-so, and his father so-and-so. No, it is the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that comes, and then the theme of the surah, and maybe the name of very important events, like Al-Baqarah, as we said, or Yusuf alayhi salam. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Ibrahim, as I mentioned in the beginning, he came with the words, and now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us about this word. And that is in verse 24. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكرون ومثل كلمة خبيثة كشجرة خبيثة اجتثت من فوق الأرض ما لها من قرار يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة ويضل الله الظالمين ويفعل الله ما يشاء. That verse number 27. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us about kalima tayyiba, a good words. And let's take a few minutes just to explain this. Alam tara kayfa daraba Allah mathalan kalimatan tayyibatan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave an example of a good word, word of iman, word of La ilaha illallah. That is what the word here, kalima tayyiba. And we say that somebody pronounced the kalima. The kalima here is La ilaha illallah. And of course, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we say Muhammadur Rasulullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave example of this beautiful words and foundation of life is kashajaratin tayyiba, as a beautiful and nice tree that has fruits all the time, and it is so high in the sky and very well settled in the earth. كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٍ It has root in the ground. And فَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ is the fruit and the bushes all over in heaven. تُؤْتِي أُكُلَهَا كُلَّ حِينٍ بِإِذْنِ رَبِّهَا It produces fruits all the time with the word of Allah and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَضْرِبُ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ So dear brothers and sisters, we know that Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said, وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ And all prophets of Allah are Muslims. So that the kalima of tawheed of Islam, of la ilaha illallah, it is the kalima for all the prophets of Allah and the believers until the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and then until the end of time when we say, la ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah. This is the kalima tayyiba, pure, beautiful. The kalima of tawheed, the kalima of iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala required us to say it. On the contrary, on the opposite, وَمَثَلُ كَلِمَةٍ خَبِيثَةٍ كَشَجَرَةٍ خَبِيثَةٍ اجْتُثَّتْ مِنْ فَوْقِ الْأَرْضِ مَا لَهَا مِنْ قَرَارٍ On the other hand, the kalima of kufr, the kalima of denying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his right over the people, and doubts, and nifaq, and the kalima of ظلم, and any other words other than لا إله إلا الله, and what entails into it, all of that will be kalima khabitha, kalima bad words, unacceptable. We cannot just say, you know, this is it. And here we can say on everything that may come to your mind. And I don't want to, you know, use so many other like terms here. But communism, capitalism, even democracy in some aspect, or dictatorship, or fascism, racism, all of those are kalima, bad words. It produces negativities and it caused trouble. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, this is like a word that cut off. And we find out throughout the history that those words harm people, hurt people, cause death to people, and unfortunately destroy the life of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يُثَبِّتُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِالْقَوْلِ الثَّابِتِ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give tathbeet. Tathbeet is like strength and confidence for the believers in this life for saying الْكَلِمَ الطَّيِّبَةِ The good words. And in the akhirah for knowing and practicing and living by لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يُحَمَّدُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ ويضل الله الظالمين because of what they are doing and what they are believing in and what they are practicing ويفعل الله ما يشاء Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do whatever he wants. Dear brothers and sisters, there is so much to say about the story of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam in this regard. Let me just move on to verse number 35 where Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam has been mentioned here in this surah and we say what is his like advice and counseling to his ummah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا وَجُنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ رَبِّ إِنَّهُنَّ أَضْلَلْنَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ فَمَنْ تَبِعَانِي فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَإِنَّكَ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ رَبَّنَا إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ الْمُحَرَّمِ رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ وَارْزُقْهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ ربنا إنك تعلم ما نخفي وما نعلن وما يخفى على الله من شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء الحمد لله الذي وهب لي على الكبر إسماعيل وإسحاق إن ربي لسميع الدعاء رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة ومن ذريتي ربنا وتقبل دعاء ربنا اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب. صدق الله العظيم. Dear brothers and sisters, there are so many beautiful meanings here to share. And I really don't want to exceed the time, but listen, it is very, very useful, inshallah. Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam telling us his dua regarding the Al-Bayt al-Haram, Mecca, where he had his first son, Ismail alayhi salam. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبَّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Ya Allah, make this city or balad. Balad is like village, city, but it is bigger than village, like couple houses. It's balad. And at that time, there was no balad. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows, and he inspired Sayyidina Ibrahim to say that. It will be a balad. Mecca will come to be. As we know, Al-Bayt al-Haram was there. And many of the Mufassirin, they would say that Al-Bayt al-Haram was really originally built by the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then rebuilt again and reestablished on the foundation of the angels by Sayyidina Ibrahim and Ismail alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying to us that وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Ya Allah, make it safety. It's a house of safety or balad of safety. وَجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَن نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. And protect me and my family and my children and my dhurriyyah, progeny, children, grandchildren, and so forth, from worshipping the asnam, statues. And unfortunately, it was established later on after Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, long time after him, and asnam was worshipped in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before that, of course, from the time of Nuh alayhi salam all the time to Ibrahim alayhi salam, asnam was worshipped even in that place as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us again about Sayyidina Ibrahim, رَبِّ إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ عِنْدَ بَيْتِكَ الْمُحَرَّمِ رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ. Ya Allah, I have left my family close to your holy place. أَسْكَنْتُ, that means second, which is housing. I left my family there, مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي, Ismail alayhi salam and Hajar alayhi salam, in the canyon where there is no plantation. And yes, there is no plantation around in Mecca and around the city, around the Haram and so on. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took care of them through Zamzam, as we know, and later on through other people coming by and developing the city. But what the purpose? What the purpose that we care about that place and we love it and we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there more than, you know, anywhere else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, for the salah, رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ وَفَجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. To establish the ibadah, the tawheed, the salah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves for us to do. And then, Ya Allah, open the hearts of the people so they can join them and be with them and go there and worship Him, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there. وَرْزُقْهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْكُرُونَ. Ya Allah, provide for them so maybe they will be thankful and appreciative. رَبَّنَا إِنَّكَ تَعْلَمُ مَا نُخْفِي وَمَا نُعْلِنُ وَمَا يَخْفَى عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what we are hiding and what we are saying. So dear brothers and sisters, what's the intention of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam? First and foremost, to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and establish the house and leave his dhurriyyah over there. And when he about to leave, after he built the house, and Sayyidina Ibrahim Ismail alayhi salam grown, it was a little before he built the house, he left Hajar and Ismail as a baby. And she asked him, Ibrahim, where are you going? Are you doing this on your own, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command you to do? He said, Allah command me to do. She said, the behavior and the activities of Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam there in Mecca, from the time he left Ismail and Hajar to the time he returned and built the house, it's all commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said, Alhamdulillah, الذي وهب لي على الكبر إسماعيل وإسحاق إن ربي لسميع الدعاء. He thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so sincerely for granting him children at a later age. At the age of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that said that he is over 80 years old when he got Ismail alayhi salam. And maybe a little older when he got Ishaq alayhi salam. And of course, in this case, it is blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he said, Rabbi ij'alni muqim as-salati wa min dhurriyyati. Now the dhurriya is good. It's good to have offspring, children, boys and girls. But the most important good in that is that they will be a Muslim and they will be worshiping like you, obeying and believing like you. And that is really the real DNA that we want to leave behind us. Whether it's in the family or the community or the society at large, that yes, alhamdulillah, we are doing good charity. We are, mashallah, you know, doctors, lawyers, engineers, etc. But what we want to leave with the people is the iman, the tawheed, the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what's important in our presence in this life, and especially if we have a position or if we are like in charge of the Islamic center or any other like institution or even alone on our own. رَبِّ اجْعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاءِ رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَّ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ. This is a wonderful dua that we need to remember and always say, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want us to include ourselves, no doubt. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي. And please, as I always sometimes mention, please be selfish in that point. Maybe don't be selfish at all, except in this point. That pray for yourself. And this is the best, to pray for each other and to pray once for his own self. And this is wonderful dua. Rabbi ighfir li, Ya Allah, forgive me. I deserve all kind of punishment. Cover my sin. Don't expose me. And in the day of judgment, make the angels forget about it. Indeed, Ya Allah, replace it instead of bad deed, good deed. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ my parents, and مُؤْمِنِينَ مُؤْمِنَات believers all over. This is a like comprehensive dua Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم taught us, and Sayyidina Ibrahim عليه السلام, he have said it. Dear brother and sister, there is so much to say about this, the remaining of the verses, which is only 52, but they are really wonderful and full of meanings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want us to learn from the prophets, and especially from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I mentioned to you, his favorite dua was رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And that is